Okay, well, I want to welcome everybody to today's Zoom. My name is Bolton Colburn. I'm the curator of collections and exhibitions at the Nora Eccles Harrison Museum of Art in Logan, Utah. And before I introduce our guest today, I wanted to talk about a few things to sort of set the stage for James's talk. One thing is that, you know, the mission of the Nora Eccles Harrison Museum of Art really is focused on art of the American West from the 20th going through to the 21st century. The collection here is composed of about 5,500 pieces, and a large share of that consists of photographs. There's about 800 photographs in the collection. This specific collection that we have drawn from in order to do the exhibition that we're going to be talking about today comes from a 1987 gift of the Marie Eccles Kane Foundation of about 107 photographs. So from that 107 photographs, we created an exhibition of 43 for the show that we're going to be talking about today. One thing that's good to remember is that this all has been made possible through the Utah Division of Arts and Museums, and also our members and donors. So thank you for your patronage. Really what drives the institution forward so that we can be open and going. So the exhibitions I'm going to talk about opened on January 28th, and they're going to close on May 8th. And they consist of, there are three exhibitions. And the exhibition that we're going to be talking about today is embedded into those three exhibitions. And I'm just going to spend a couple of minutes doing a screen share with you to show you how to get to those exhibitions on a virtual tour. So let me do that now. Let's see here. You just go to your, go to your web browser and type in Nora Eccles Harrison Museum of Art. And you go to the museum's website. You hit the exhibitions tab, and then for the show that we're going to be talking about today, Three Depression Era Photographers, you click on the link there, and then you can see the virtual tour button. You click that, and that embeds you into to the exhibition. One thing I wanted to note is that in this exhibition, we have a reproduction of a catalog that was done of the collection in 1988 by Peter Briggs. And you can go onto that button there by the publication, and you can click it, and you'll get a PDF of the publication. So kind of a fun thing to do. So I'm going to introduce James R. Swensen to you now. He is an associate professor of art history and the history of photography at Brigham Young University. His research interests include documentary photography, American photography, and the visual representation of the American West. He is the author of several articles and two books, and those books are Picturing Migrants, The Grapes of Wrath, and New Deal Documentary Photography, and that was published by the University of Oklahoma Press in 2015. And the second book is In a Rugged Land, Ansel Adams, Dorothea Lange, and the Three Mormon Towns Collaboration, 1953 to 1954. published by the University of Utah Press in 2018. And for that book, he, James, received the Best Book Award from the Utah Historical Society in 2019, and the Evans Biography Award in 2020 from Utah State University's Mountain West Center for Regional Studies. James is currently writing a book on the New Deal documentary photography in Utah. So before I turn it over to him, I wanted to say that if you have questions, you can post them in the Q&A section of your Zoom presentation, and we will be getting to those questions at the end of James's presentation, which will be about 20 to 25 minutes. So James, please take it away.
All right, let me just make sure. Okay, I'm hoping you can see my screen all right. Bolton, does that look okay?
Looks good.
Well, I'd like to begin by thanking the Nora Eccles Harrison Museum of Art for inviting me. I am a big fan of what they do, and they've got a great collection. I'd also like to thank Bolton for setting this all up, as well as Philip Brown. Again, thank you for making this possible. Today, as Bolton said, I'm going to be speaking about three New Deal documentary photographers who are working in Utah. And the three that we're going to look at today, and was just asked to provide a nice overview, and I look forward to your questions after I'm done. But the three photographers are Dorothea Lange, Arthur Rothstein, and Russell Lee. Now, as a little bit of a caveat, I've got to admit that this is a project that is very close to what I've been doing for the last 20 years. As an undergraduate, I received a grant to study this work, just serendipitously found when I made it to the Library of Congress. Looking at Dorothea Lange was part of my master's thesis, and really for the last 20 years or so now, this has been a big part of what I do. So when Bolton asked if I could speak about this material, I think I unloaded on him on all the ways in which this has been a part of what I've been doing in my scholarship. So I'm thankful for this opportunity to go back, and it's like visiting old friends here. Anyway, the three photographers that I'm gonna be looking at, Lange, Rothstein, and Lee, came to Utah at a very important time. Lange is gonna come in 1936 and again in 1938. Rothstein's gonna make a quick visit in 1940. And Lee is going to do the most extensive work of the three when he comes to Utah in 1940. And just a word about Utah during the Great Depression. It's important to remember that hard times came to Utah well before the stock market crash on October 29th, 1929. The two primary industries of Utah, which were farming and mining, were hit already by the early 1920s. Drought and high unemployment reaching about 36% at its height in the Great Depression. All these things came together and really propelled Utah into the thick of the Great Depression. It was always high on the list of those states that were receiving federal aid during this period of time. And it was in dire straits and dire needs. And remember that in 1932, when Franklin Delano Roosevelt became president, he initiated a series of sweeping changes, including the creation of several new agencies. These agencies became known as the alphabet agencies, because the WPA for the Works Progress Administration, or the TVA, or again, all of these kind of acronyms that added up to these agencies. And there were two in particular that were important for our purposes today. One was the Resettlement Administration, and the second was the Farm Security Administration, which actually is created out of the RA in 1937. The federal government, Roosevelt and Rexford Tugwell, who was in charge of the RA, knew that these were going to be controversial programs. And so he brought on an old colleague by the name of Roy Stryker, who you can see here on the right in this photograph, to photograph what the agency was doing. Stryker was a good administrator and had a talent for finding goods photographers, hired a number of what have now become some of the most important names in documentary photography to not only document what the agency was doing, but also to create a record. In other words, he wanted to introduce America to Americans. So it's through this that we come to the documentation of Utah. And the first that was sent here is arguably one of the most famous names in photography. When I ask my history of photography students to name a photographer, they can usually come up with a few at the beginning of class. Ansel Adams is usually there, and usually next to it is Dorothea Lange. Lange was born in Hoboken, New Jersey, and she knew that she wanted to be a photographer even before she picked up a camera. In New York, she studied with Clarence White and with others, and eventually made her way out to San Francisco, where she set up her own portrait studio and married the famous Western painter, Maynard Dixon. She started a family, and yet by 1932, even her studio, which had catered to some of the most wealthy members of the Bay Area, by 1932, she realized that big things were changing. And so she started to take her camera out of the studio and to the streets. It's about the same time that she starts to notice, again, especially in these few years leading up to from 32 onward, the migration of Okies and Arkies and others coming out of the Dust Bowl in the Midwest in search of a better life in California. This is what we primarily remember Dorothea Lange for, and her enthusiasm for documenting these individuals and hopefully bringing their plight to the attention of others was infectious, so much so that even Maynard Dixon, who we tend to think about as creating these very beautiful Western landscapes, some of my favorite paintings, even Dixon, who resisted wanting to get involved with politics and things, was thrust into these difficult times. But one of the most important assignments that, well, actually it wasn't an assignment, but one of the most important events in Lange's career was in 1936. She'd been hired by Roy Stryker, and she had been in Southern California, in Central California, documenting various projects. On the way home to her studio in Oakland, she saw a sign for a pea picking camp just outside of NEHMA, California. She stopped, took out her camera, right, focused on one family, and I think you can see where this is going. And out of that came what is her most famous photograph, arguably one of the most famous photographs that have ever been taken. I'm sure that for those of you who are joining us, you've probably seen this image in one form or another. Here we have her migrant mother. And the reason why I bring this up is not only because it's her most famous photograph, but 2 weeks later, she's in Utah. The three places I'm just going to briefly focus on are her three primary assignments. She's going to photograph Consumers, which is a small coal mining town in Carbon County. And then she would work her way down to the south central Utah, focusing on Woodso and Escalante. So I'm going to focus first on Consumers. You know, when you think of Utah, you tend to think of, and this was especially true then, you tend to think of Mormons and farmers. We forget how important mining was. At the time, mining accounted for 54% of Utah's economy. And that's in hard metals, but as well as coal in Carbon County. And coal mining had been hit really hard in the 1920s in particular. In fact, one observer noted this. He said, in the whole range of the Depression, there is nothing worse than the condition of soft coal miners. When Lange made it down to through Helper and then into the hill, the pinyon covered hills, which are actually halfway between Price and Helper, she made it to Consumers, which is located along Gordon Creek. And here she photographed the Blue Blaze coal mine. She also photographed the company store and the company house, which was typically, as you can see here in this photograph, inadequate, leaky, and for the most part, covered with tar paper for insulation. But it was her work with the citizens of this kind of poor a really hard scrabble coal mining camp that are the most important things she does in consumers. And here we see her photograph of a coal miner either coming home from work or heading to the mines, his shiny lunch pail, which you can see around his arms, is the shiniest thing, especially in juxtaposition with his tattered layers of tattered clothing. And even though obviously the conditions are dire, as you can see in this image, Lange was known for being able to create sympathetic portraits. The low vantage point here, in fact, highlights the miner, increases his stature and status, really, and almost his scale within the photograph. And also coupled with that kind of steely expression, right, shows a figure who's able to endure, which is one of the things that Lange wanted to emphasize and which Stryker wanted to see in his photographs. There's another set of pictures though that I think is almost just as interesting. In five photographs, she's gonna focus on a small mining family. Again, this is a bituminous mine, right, camp. And she focuses on these three individuals, a mother, small son, and a young daughter. She photographs them here in front of their home, which again is just a single room tar paper shack. But probably the most famous photographs are those where she has them actually walk up the street, again, working through, right, the soggy, muddy, right, slush, right, of late March. And you can sense, right, the plight of these poor mining families, which suffered not only from poor inadequate housing, but dropping wages. Also, there were times in which, especially here in consumers, in which they were laid off for a certain amount of days every month. So Lange here emphasizes, and again, almost creates these symbols in these mining camps of those who are able to persevere under these circumstances. From consumers, again, and by the way, nothing exists of consumers today. So everything you've seen in these photographs is completely gone. But from here, she goes to another area. And this one area was in particular of importance and interest for the resettlement administration. The Woodso resettlement project was slated to take and remove people who were living in Woodso and move them to more prosperous towns in Utah and the West. And there was a reason for this. Woodso had been settled late. This drive of trying to create trying to make the desert bloom really hit the wall here in many ways. Woodso is located in Johns Valley, which is 7,600 feet in elevation. It has a shortened growing season. The soil is poor, actually quickly, right, was exhausted, and it was suffering from overgrazing. This was the perfect case study, case project for the resettlement administration. And so when you see individuals like this, I like how Bolton used this for our ad today, that this had all the hope, right, that the resettlement administration was gonna come in and move these clients to some better place. Actually in Cache County and other places, Utah County is where these farmers were moved. At its height, Woodso had a population of 1,100. By the time Lange was there, it had dropped down well below 200. And of those 200, she shows, right, where they were living. And, you know, she made a good case for why they needed to be moved. By March, you should be planting already. You should start working your fields. But she showed poor housing and the fields still covered with thick snow. And although she noted that Woodso was 100% Mormon, that was her what she wrote in her field notes, you can see how that perseverance and faith were really challenged at this point in time and in Woodso. And probably my favorite photograph from this series is this. Here we have a photograph of a 70-year-old migrant, LDS convert, who had joined the church in Copenhagen, came out to the American West alone at age 14. The woman who is photographed here is named Christina Marie Hansen Snyder. And when Lange photographed Snyder, she had just received her first old age check or her first social security check, which were meant, right, as they said, for the needy aged. And yet look at, it had to be strange in some ways for Lange because look at the juxtapositions here. of, here we have Snyder dressed in her fur-covered lined coat, clutching her purse and her check, and against this backdrop of desolation. It had, again, there were obvious concerns here, and I think you can see in many ways the sorrow. Lange photographed her twice, and I think in both you can sense this kind of downcast expression for someone who is now completely dependent upon the government for her aid. From Woodso, and again, moving through these quickly, but she moves to Escalante. It's a difficult drive from Woodso to Escalante. In Woodso, she saw the death of a town, and there is very little that survives in Woodso. It's a ghost town that you can reach, actually, if you drive just north of Bryce Canyon. She had to be curious whether Escalante would suffer a similar fate. And when she arrives, she shows a town that was literally teetering at this point. 70% of Escalante, the residents of Escalante, were on federal relief. So there was a good case to be made for a similar fate to Woodso. But there were other reasons why she went. Her good friend Lowry Nelson was in the middle of his study on Escalante and other Mormon villages. Also, 2 years prior to this, her young friend Everett Roos, who some of you may know, again, we were very interested in Roos and his art, his poetry, his writing, and his disappearance. Roos, who was a good friend of Maynard Dixon and Dorothea Lange, disappeared. The last place he was seen, actually, was Escalante. So this had to be a part of the reason why she was coming to this very isolated community. But instead of instability, she photographed a town that had a pioneering heritage, evident in photographs of this couple, which she photographed over and over again, converts to Mormonism, as she says in her captions from South Africa. She is the first school teacher in Escalante, and here they are photographed in their Sunday best against a background, not of planks and decay like you saw in Woodso, but against sturdy buildings that if you go to Escalante today, you can still see evidence of. And there was another reason though. When she went to Escalante, she was also very interested in what she called, and just forgive me, I just gotta turn a page here. She was very interested in creating what she called a study of a Mormon village. And you know this, if you've traveled around enough through the West, and this was evidence now as it was in the past, there are just certain characteristics of Mormon, small Mormon towns. So she's gonna photograph the wide streets. How many of you have experienced a wide street in a small Mormon town? She's gonna photograph, right, the cluster of the community together, the open irrigation ditches. I'm not saying this is the most beautiful photograph on earth, but she's trying to illustrate a point here. She is also gonna photograph the homes after, as she says, that Utah pattern, right? And the fields separated from the farmhouses, outside of the community, and barns that were unpainted. Again, all of these things were important markers, visual markers of a Mormon town. And probably the most obvious was the church, which was located in the very heart or center, according to the Mormon plat. And Lange photographed, right, the old stately but church that clearly had better days but was representative of these Mormon characteristics. In 1970, the geographer Richard Francavilla is going to write, in fact, talk about the Mormon landscape, and he's going to give 9 characteristics that mark and set a Mormon town apart from others. Lange and Escalante photographed 9 of those. Really creating one of these great illustrations of what an old Mormon town looked like. She's going to return one last time in 1938, and this time she's going to go to Springdale, just outside of Zion National Park, and here she photographed peaches, right, the peach harvest, and which were sold to tourists like herself. Even though this image appears as if there are better times in Utah, 1938 was actually one of the lowest points in the Great Depression, what's called the Roosevelt Recession. And so, right, again, it's hopeful, but at the same time, it was coming at difficult times for small Mormon Utah towns. Just a plug here, right, Lange is going to do a lot of other work in Southern Utah. And if you're interested in this, right, she's going to come back in 1953 with Ansel Adams. But that, my friends, is a story for another time. All right, let's get to our next photographer we're going to look at briefly. and that's Arthur Rothstein. Rothstein was a kid from the Bronx. His first job out of college actually was working for Roy Stryker. Not a bad gig. And one of his earliest assignments was being sent out on the road for months on end. Again, he called himself a provincial New Yorker, which is a kind of a wonderful oxymoron. But he's going to be sent out to for months on end. And one of his first assignments was to the Dust Bowl. And his most famous photograph was made on one of these first assignments, in which he photographed in Cimarron County, which is in the panhandle of Oklahoma, this young family fleeing from the dust storm. Now, when Rothstein comes to Utah, he doesn't have an assignment. His assignment is to get to California to document migrant camps like those that John Steinbeck talked about in Grapes of Wrath. However, he was encouraged by Stryker to photograph anything along the way. Rothstein has this great point. He says this: to me, being a New Yorker and finding myself out west in the Great Plains, anywhere west of the Hudson River, was a revelation. It was like getting a PhD. I spent 5 years traveling. I went to every one of the 3,000 counties in the United States. Okay, first, that's a little bit of hyperbole. He doesn't go to every one of the 3,000 counties in the United States, but he does go to a lot of them. And he covers, again, he's on the road for months at a time. He keeps an axe and a radio and extra clothing and a sleeping bag in his car because he just never knows what's going to happen. And so when you look at his work in Utah, think of it as this illustration of a photographer, a young photographer enamored by the West and the open road and the road trip, working his way through northern Utah. He's going to document actually when he gets to Utah, and he's going to travel through again what is today more or less Interstate 80. Then it was US 30 and US 40. In Summit County, he's going to document a haystacker. This is another one of those markers of the Mormon West. The FSA actually wanted to create an encyclopedia of farming. And so they were very interested in how farmers in different places stack their hay. If you've traveled through the West, you've seen, right, variation from Montana to Utah and Oregon and elsewhere. They were very interested in this, and this was the famous Mormon hay derrick. If you're wanting to know where this is, in the background here is, this is Snyderville. So this is the old Park West, Wolf Mountain, the canyons, and now Park City Ski Resort. So this is right where he was making these photographs. And you can see, again, an individual who would stop, get out of his car, photograph these open roads. And there's a sense of these being very autobiographical. And anything along the ways. He thought this was one of his best photographs. I don't necessarily, but he was interested in form and variation from place to place. If he had one assignment, it was to document Bingham Canyon, the famous copper pit, now called Kennecott, right? That's in the southern part of Salt Lake Valley, southwestern part of Salt Lake Valley. And here, like other tourists, he drove up, parked his car, and photographed what the WPA Guide to the State called, what seemed like a stadium for giants. And if you look closely, you can see, right, the small trains hauling ore up from the bottom to be processed into copper. War had already begun in Europe, and increasingly Stryker and his team are gonna be focused on the industries. But that's not gonna really kick in until a couple years later. He does, though, take the opportunity to photograph the miners' homes, again, building on where Lange left off, to show the plight of individuals who were literally, as Wallace Stegner wrote, were stacked upon each other in Bingham Canyon, in homes that were often falling apart or non-existent. As he headed west, right, he was going to drive through the Great Salt Lake Desert. And as you know, right, this has always been a kind of a perilous journey. Even today, he photographs the signs telling him to check his water bag. And about 40 miles west of Grantsville, on the backside of the Cedar Mountain Range, he again stopped his car, took out his camera. By the way, he needed to try it. This is a large format camera that he was using. Put his tripod in the middle of the road and photographed directly to the west. This is someone who, right, was seeing many parts, seeing the United States for the first time. understanding that the United States is multiple landscapes, and Utah in particular, as the WBA guide said, was many things at once. He would go on again to the state line, Utah-Nevada state line, and here he would also photograph Wendover. This is Wendover before gambling arrives. This is Wendover before the Wendover bombing site, bombing grounds were produced here. In fact, over the next few years, tens of thousands of people would move to Wendover. And I think if you look at, including, by the way, the pilot of the Enola Gay, right, who would drop the bomb on Hiroshima in 1945. But I think here, if you look at this, there's no reason why this couldn't be a bombing test center for bombing. There's really nothing here other than flat ground, which I think is confirmed in Rothstein's photograph. Don't get me wrong, I love the desert, but I think, right, he's trying to make that case. All right, the last photographer, and I know I'm running short on time, is Russell Lee. Russell Lee was born in Kansas to a wealthy farming family. He trained to be a chemical engineer, but he also married a painter by the name of Doris Emmerich Lee. And in due time, he decided that he left his career in engineering and dedicated himself to being an artist. Now, he quickly realized that he was a better photographer than painter. And by 1936, Roy Stryker is going to hire him. And Lee will be the most prolific photographer on Stryker's team. Lee is going to visit in the summer and fall of 1940, two places in Utah. He's going to focus in northern Utah in the summer and then make his way down to Washington County by the fall and winter. A nice choice of locations, right, if you know Utah weather. And so think about how different this is, right? Obviously, northern Utah and Box Elder and Cache counties are very different from the terrain and landscape of Santa Clara and southern Utah. And yet the thing that unites them is this interest in the Mormon farmer. In 1936, the Church of Jesus Christ of Latter-day Saints decided to pull their membership out of the New Deal. They were concerned that it was making their members idle and that they were, you know, just relying or taking advantage of the public dole, as they called it. And yet, and why that was praised by many, it was also criticized by others who realized and could readily cite the fact that Utah still ranked high in terms of federal support. From 1937 to 1939, more than 7,400 farm families were receiving direct aid. So direct aid from the Farm Security Administration alone. So when Russell Lee comes out for the FSA, he's clearly interested in showing these individuals who, on the one hand, are exemplars of cooperation, again, and virtues that are going to help the United States, they believe, to pull us out of the depression. But at the same time, right, as individuals who are heavily invested in the New Deal and the Farm Security Administration in particular. And Lee is inquisitive and curious. And before he comes up north, he makes a tour of Temple Square. He visits church archives. And I think the photographs, and I would argue the photographs that he makes are seen through this experience, or what he calls his Mormon documentation is what he calls it. So for example, a photograph of the expanse of sage and juniper, which you can readily find in Box Elder County. This is, as he titles this piece, upon this land similar to this, Brigham Young looked when he said, this is the place. Now, you know, that's not exactly true, but nonetheless, it was seen through that lens. So he's gonna photograph the Mormon hay derrick. He's gonna photograph the Lombardy poplars, which were brought in, especially by early white settlers to the Intermountain West as windbreaks, but became so ubiquitous within Mormon communities that they were actually called Mormon trees. And think of, as you travel through Utah, the things you still see that are indicative of the Mormon landscape. And yet he was interested in, right, finding evidence of their production, of their cooperation, of their self-reliance. in this rather dramatic landscape. And as I said before, he was interested too. Again, his assignment was to show co-ops, these Mormon farmers engaged in New Deal, or more specifically, Farm Secured Administration programs. Many of these farmers were receiving loans, right, to help them at this point in time. And even more were actually part of co-ops. And if you look at it, there are, he's going to show all sorts of co-ops. He shows, right, here we have the West Bear River Ditcher Co-op in action. What this is you have farmers come together, and with the support and being enabled by the Farm Security Administration, they would pull their money together so that they could purchase expensive farm equipment that they could not normally buy, like a thresher, like you see these two farmers photographed in front of. Or again, the cooperative side. Now I know a lot of these are kind of boring administrative photographs, and that's what they were supposed to be. He wanted to show how much the Farm Security Administration was benefiting the lives of these Mormon farmers. My personal favorite, by the way, is the manure spreader, right, which you see here. I bet this is not on the walls of the Nora Eccles Harrison Museum, but it shows the depth to which these farmers were pulling their resources, coming together with the support of the FSA to improve their right techniques and their farming, and the theory goes, their lives, right? This in fact is the result of a manure spreader. The, as you can see, the figure on the your right, on your left is on an unmanured part, and on the right, a place that had benefited from manure. Now, you probably didn't think like, you're coming together to talk about manure today, but think of how this is a part of what Lee was trying to do. I should also put in a plug too that he was going to work in Logan. So when you go to the Nora Eccles Harrison Museum to see this exhibition, Lee was working there. Here he created actually a panorama looking just south of campus and of the State Agricultural College. In these, he really was thinking about this as an idealized farming community that was bringing together not just the practice and better farming techniques, but the science and the theories of farming, right? This larger, right, productive agriculture and community that Lee was very interested in. Right? As part of this, he's also going to photograph, right, the families. Again, that's a very important part of what he was trying to do. So not just the farmer at work, but the larger, right, culture of productivity and cooperation, not just working on the farms together, but things like quilting parties that were all about community based on self-reliance and cooperation. I'll do a couple more things. I know I'm running a little bit out of time. As part of this, he's going to document the activities of the LDS faith. He gets in Mendon, which is just west of Logan, he gets to know the mayor and the bishop. The bishop invites him to church, and it's here, in fact, he's allowed to set up his camera right at the pulpit, and here photographed in this case. This is Hansel Sorensen and her Sunday school class. And you can just see, I love this photograph because you can just see how inquisitive. This is not a normal Sunday for these young members. But that whole idea of who they were, what they did, what they sung, how they performed. And Roy Stryker actually was asked his photographers to not only get photographs of religion and faith, but to get photographs of members of the faithful leaving their churches. And this is true, by the way, in the South and the West and the Midwest, as well as it was in Mendon. And here you can see, right, Lee photographing the present state, where if you compare this with what Lange was doing, Lange was very much interested in the pioneering past, right? This has a very different feel. Just lastly, Lee is also going to go to Southern Utah. Many of the same themes that dominate, right, what he does up north are carried over to the fall, including probably my favorite, couple of my favorite photographs of all of the FSA in Utah. The old war church with its beautiful Gothic arches, the Relief Society building, right? But it wasn't just the building. Lee actually goes to the meetings of the Relief Society, or what he calls the Welfare Society, and seeing it through the lens of the New Deal. And he photographs their activities. He also photographs their old bishop. Right here we have E.R. Fry, who served as bishop for a number of decades. It was also the mayor, the school teacher, and the justice of the peace. But again, it was families, right? And one of the other markers of Mormon communities was the fecundity of the right population. It was the abundance of children. This is still right one of the markers of Utah. And so Lee here is not only going to show them at work, at its school, at play, but is also as vibrant members of the community. Last photograph I'll show you from the series is probably my favorite. And here we see a photograph of what he says is an old resident of Santa Clara with pictures of some of her forebears. This is a photograph of Barbara Graff, right, who was the first child born to the white settlers of Santa Clara in 1861. On the background, in the background, you can see her parents right above her head, her husband, her late husband on your right, and other relatives here. Like a constellation, right? You can see the juxtaposition and the ways in which this senior member, this pioneering member of the community is right, a part of this much larger heritage and tradition that connects past and present. I'll just say in passing that these photographs were created now close to a century ago, but they have continued to live on. When you open up history books of Utah history, this is the textbook, by the way, I had when I was in seventh grade. In introducing the Great Depression, here you have a photograph of Christina Marie Hansen Snyder. You have photographs of right consumers by Lange as well as Springdale. And this continues to this day. And so think about these images from the past, how we use them and what they mean to us. And they are rich in terms of not only what they say, but in terms of understanding where we are. And so with that, I'd just like to say thanks again. And I look forward to your questions. So Bolton.
Yeah, thanks, James. That's an amazing talk. You've added a lot to the subject here, which is great. There is one or two questions. There's one question about whether or not these three photographers ever got together, or I guess the second part of the question is, were they cognizant of what areas each were going to photograph geographically?
Good question. So Roy Stryker's team was made up of obviously these disparate individuals, and Dorothea Lange actually was assigned to the West. She was called Region Number 9 that incorporated in Utah. So she was because she was in the Bay Area, she was the one assigned Utah, what was it, Arizona, California, Idaho, Washington, Oregon. And so at first she was the only one really working out here. Lange is gonna have a rocky relationship with the FSA and Stryker. And so by the time you get to 1938, there's really only two photographers working. That's Rothstein and Lee, who we looked at. Now, they were familiar, especially these later photographers were familiar with the work. It was being collected and used and actually published very early on in the history of Stryker's team. They had access to the files where they could look through the photographs. They knew each other. When Rothstein comes out to California, he's gonna go to Lange's house and they're gonna sit down and talk about things. Rothstein and Lee were close friends, so they communicated and they were always communicating with Stryker. So there was this network and this connected network in which they knew what they were doing, even if they weren't collaborating in the same spot. I mean, they tended to be kind of spread out to maximize coverage. But yeah, they were very aware of each other. They were, you know, most of them are friends throughout their lives. And so yeah, great question.
Here's another question. Are there other examples of the US government hiring photographers to document American life outside of the New Deal era? And how many artists were hired, or specifically photographers, by
FSA? It's a good question. The FSA is a part of what's now called the FSA OWI collection. And during the war, World War II, there is another one of these alphabet agencies known as the Office of War Information, or OWI. Stryker is actually folded into that team. They hire other photographers like Andreas Feiniger and other kind of really kind of, high-powered photographers. And so during the war, you've got this continued amassing of photographs that become part of this FSA OWI collection that numbers around 270,000 images. That is the largest photo archive, or the largest kind of combined photography project in American history. There have been attempts to do something similar. In the 1970s, you have Rothstein. By the way, Dorothea Lange always wanted something similar to happen, but she died in 1965 before anything could happen. In the 1970s, you get Rothstein and Senator Walter Mondale, saying, look, we need to do another one of these large-scale documentations. The American Bicentennial was about to happen. And so they really try to push forward something that can go back and send young photographers out across the United States to do something similar to what the FSA was doing under Stryker. It kind of peters out. Actually, it does peter out. They never were able to do it. Again, it's an expensive endeavor. And even in its day, Stryker was always trying to keep the wolves at bay, because there were those who were trying to get rid of what he had done because it was such a great expense to American taxpayers. So in the 1970s, even with all this motivation and desire to do it, it falls flat. Now, you do have other projects. The courthouse project in the 1970s sends very talented photographers across the United States to document courthouses, beautiful small courthouses. Photographers like Stephen Shore, and again, just talented, great photographers are a part of that. That's not funded by the federal government, but by the Seagram Corporation, right? Seagram Beverage Corporation. The EPA actually is, if there is a follow-up to the FSA in which federal sponsorship of photography is the EPA in the 1970s, it is actually able to send some of these same photographers out to document EPA projects across the United States. And that's a body of work that has some work done on it, but a lot of really interesting things that these young photographers, men and women, are doing across the United States. So long-winded answer to the question, but a very good one.
Here's another question. How important do you think it is that these three photographers were not from the areas they were photographing? And how do you, having studied them, think their outsider perspective inform their work?
You know, that's a great question, because I think there's advantages to be an insider, there's advantages to being an outsider. And I think in this case, they were able to come in with eyes wide open to see what was here. I think Lange is probably the best example. I mean, Lange will famously say, like, look, I was thrust in these situations and I responded and I was there to document the human condition. Now Lange would do a lot of homework, but even then, just being in a place, right, seeing the circumstances and the situations up front, gave them, right, this opportunity to kind of to document it in a way that probably an insider wouldn't. I think consumers is probably the best example of that, where, you know, Lange is coming in with an understanding of how to make sympathetic images, but really responding to what, and I didn't mention this, it was called the dumping ground of the West. But to photograph these people against that, right, to show them of worth, even in this dumping ground, things like that you just can't prepare for. And if it's a Utah photographer or a Mormon photographer, they would probably respond to this very differently, I think.
Right. Okay, a last question here. And it is about how do you think the work of these photographers were perceived by the art world at the time?
Good question. So there's always this kind of delicate balance between art and documentary photography. Lange kind of bristles about being called an artist, but at other times, right, her art is being shown in the Museum of Modern Art, right? So there's this delicate balance. You know, if you look at a lot of these photographs, many of them are of pure documentary value. Like many of those photographs of Lee, who was known to take more photographs than anybody else to create series. But if, you know, I don't know if I look, when I look at that photograph of the farmers lined up on top of the manure spreader, I don't know if I'd call that art, right? I mean, he was there for a specific purpose to document this thing, to create a document that could work alongside numbers and statistics and, you know, anecdotes. Again, all the things you would need for a document to send to Congress. At the same time, though, they're all very aware that their work is being seen as art. As I said before, their work is, even in the 1930s, is being shown at the Museum of Modern Art. It's being brought into the collection. They understand that they're working in both of these discourses. And for somebody like Russell Lee, it makes sense. I mean, he studied to be an artist. His wife, who he, by the way, he would divorce in 1940 from Doris Lee, would go on to become one of the better known regionalist artists out there. So they're small circles. Even Beaumont Newhall, who's the curator of photography for the Museum of Art, is kind of contemplating, are they art? But they're always being talked about by, right, museums and curators. So even early on, they're kind of elevated to that status, even if they didn't want to be called artists.
Okay, I've got one last question. I noticed the omission of Native Americans in Utah while some were farming at this time. Was that just in Utah, more broadly in FSA?
No, so this is another project. I've got a bunch of FSA projects that I've been working on for a long time. one of the real kind of absences you do see, the kind of the holes in this documentation, is with Native Americans. And there's a couple of reasons for this. The first is that the FSA, we have to understand, we talk about the FSA as being the window to the Great Depression, but it is a very, you know, it's a specific documentation. It was not meant to show everything, right? In fact, it doesn't do a good job of showing what's happening in cities. That was not its job, right? And so it was focused on white farmers. Well, white, actually, that's not true. It was focused on white and black farmers all across the United States. Native Americans are represented in a way in the FSA, but it was more, if they were in an area, right? Let's say in Rothstein's in Western Nevada, and he makes his way to photograph, right, Native Americans in the reservation. Stryker didn't send his team out, his photographers out, to photograph Native Americans. In fact, he says, look, that's the job of other agencies, particularly the BIA, right, under John Collier Sr. And so they were really kind of territorial when it came to Native Americans. And yeah, if you go online, you can actually, you know, search through the collections and you will find images of Native Americans, some really great ones. But in terms of the overall percentage, it's small because there were some of these territorial squabbles and it wasn't a part of what the FSA was doing. That was left to other agencies, which is unfortunate because, you know, Rothstein actually writes to Stryker, says, look, I really want to go photograph this reservation. And Stryker says, look, that's not our job. I'm sick and tired of images of Indians. This is your job. Go do it. So, and I'm paraphrasing poorly, but... so that's the reason why you're not seeing more of these, and in Utah in particular.
You bring up a good point, just one of your last comments, and that is that people can go online to the Library of Congress to see what all the photographs that were done, or what portion of those photographs are available to see
A majority of them. What's great about this is because these were made for a federal agency, they are in the public domain. You owe them, you own them as a taxpayer. And so if you go online and just Google FSA OWI photographs, you'll be taken to the Library of Congress webpage, and there you can actually search anything. Like if, and it's kind of a fun exercise. You know, if you're from Georgia, put it in your hometown, see what pops up. The other nice thing about these is not only are they there to search, but you can download high quality JPEGs and TIFFs that you could print, you could put on your own walls. I mean, they are there for you. And so, yeah, it's a really wonderful collection to work with because it is so accessible.
Right. Well, thank you. I appreciate your time and your scholarship in this area. It's fantastic.
It's my pleasure.
Thank you so much.
Thank you.
We'll see you.
Thank you for your questions, everybody.